position in he is an editor for the Platonic Mind. In an introduction of this Platonic Mind, I give to speak on Plato, on the origin and development of the theory of thought.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So, is it on? Is it on now? Like that? So, this paper is on the Phaedo, but really I want to introduce you to a project that I am beginning and in which this part of on the Phaedo fits in, which is, and this project is on the origin and development of the theory of flames, and perhaps more accurately on the basis, the justification behind forms. So you have, I hope you can see the handout there. Anyway, in my recent monograph, so I'll tell you first something about the project in general, and then I'll come to the Phaedo. So in my recent monograph, The Structure of Inquiry in Plato's Early Dialogues, which came out last year, I set out to investigate the source of Plato's essentialism in dialogues commonly considered early. Essentialism, the commitment to essences, the demand for definitions, the TST question, and so on and so forth. I propose that what is behind Plato's commitment to essences and the search for essences is a certain view of intellectual inquiry or inquiry, which says that the prime mover in such inquiry is a peculiar type of questions, namely questions that articulate aporia or certain kind of aporia, which are called radical aporia, aporia in the sense of conflicts of reasons. And I argue that Plato shows that we can search for and can find answers to such questions, that is, questions that are articulate aporia. They are typically of the whether or not potter of a questions. We can find, we can search for and find answers to such questions if the questions are sufficiently, if the aporia are sufficiently strong or radical, as I say, if and only if we suppose that there are essences and that essences may be known to us through searching. So the project there was to find the justification, or to find some justification behind Plato's commitment to essences, to definitions, to the search for the Tiesti. And this project is the next step, is a further step in this ongoing project, which I seem to be settled on for the rest of my life, whatever. Because the next dialogue is Phaedo and Republic, and whereas it's generally acknowledged that Plato introduces a basic commitment to essences in dialogues commonly considered earlier than the Phaedo, it's also generally acknowledged, I think, that this commitment takes on an elaborate and peculiar character in dialogues such as especially the Phaedo, the Republic, and that's what we refer to as the theory of forms. And the question I want to address is why and for what reasons does Plato defend not only a basic commitment to essences, but a more elaborate and peculiar account of essences? Now, the thesis I want to defend, and in which this the Phaedo is an important part, is this, that Plato arrived at this elaborate account of essences on the basis of, first, this basic account of essence from the earlier dialogues, and secondly, elements that, even if they are new in the order of exposition, are logically inseparable from that account. I mean, are logically inseparable from the account of essences in the early dialogues. And I think this thesis is a distinctive thesis. It stands opposed to a variety of views, which I think are quite common, which claim that whereas, of course, one source of the origin or one source of the theory of forms is the commitment to essences, I mean, nobody would deny that, this is not sufficient to arrive at the full theory. Rather, that theory is based on essences, the commitment to essences, plus some additional elements. And the important thing here is that these additional elements are considered by those who hold this common view to be logically independent from the commitment to essences. Now, the kind of thing I have in mind is, for example, the element, the independent element sometimes referred to as the flux thesis, which goes back to Aristotle's famous account of the origin of the theory of forms in the book Alpha of the Physics. I mean, Aristotle, of course, acknowledges that essences, that's what he says comes from Socrates, is the one element that drives the Plato's commitment to forms, but he says there's another element that comes from the Heracliteans, which is this conception of nature as being in flux or in radical change of some kind. Now, the important thing for present purposes is just to know that these two elements are logically independent of each other. It's not just that there is something new, but the new thing is not really, it's like a menu, you know, you like whipped cream and you like lager, so you have a bit of both. And that's kind of what I'm against. And this, the element of this project that's addressed to Fido is likewise opposed to what I would think is in some ways parallel. So if you think of the idea, which I'll come back to in a moment, that when Plato introduces the claim that causation, explanation, aitia, however you want to translate, it doesn't matter, causation, let's say, requires forms, on many views, there's a principle there that the cause must be like the effect, that the form must be F, and that the cause of anything that is F must be F. Or if you like, better put it the other way around, the cause of anything that is F, the cause must itself be F, and we may suppose that the form is F, and so forms plus this principle give us a good account of causation. But if you think about this principle, that the cause must be like the effect, or that the cause of the things being F must itself be F, I mean, that principle, whatever its origin historically or plausibility, really, as far as I can see, has nothing to do with an account of essence. It's logically independent of an account of essence. And so, if we want to, if as I do, we want to argue that the theory of forms is a theory of essence and nothing else, then we have to find a different account of that famous passage in the Phaedo, 95b following, where he introduces the claim that all causation must be based on forms. I'm not saying only forms, but at least primarily on forms. Let me see. So I have 22 passes. So, I mean, that's the main idea. If you scroll down a bit, please. Oh, there we go. Yes, no, that's fine. That's good. So I'll just say one more thing about the general project before I turn to the Fido. The claim is not. I'm not a sort of an old-fashioned Unitarian that we have forms already in the early dialogues and that everything that we find later is there already earlier. That's not the claim. The claim is that we have some core elements of an account of essence and of what is required to defend this account. So the two elements that are identified in the early dialogues are, of course, the commitment to essences, but also these radical aporia that if you follow this line of argument, is what supports what but provides the justification for the commitment to assistance. So you have these two elements in the early dialogues that are not logically independent of each other, which go together. And then there are various ways of saying that Plato unfolds this, that he develops the theory of essence in various ways, which can be quite complex and not such that we can just anticipate them. We couldn't anticipate that this would happen, as if the logic, what follows from something is not already there in Nietzsche, in what comes out of it. It's a creative and non-anticipated development, but it's nevertheless a development that has not drawn anything new. New in the sense of logically independent. It's all either, as I say, articulating the notion of essence or necessary for the justification of the articulation of the notion of essence or derivable from these two first points. Now, yes, and that's this. And what I identify is six or seven elements in the full theory of forms, and maybe more. But this is how I am at the moment. So essences are necessary for intellectual inquiry. Essences cannot be exhibited in sense perception. Then we come to the crucial Fido point. Essences are necessary for all explanation. And the further ones, which just to mention, the qualities of which that essence are primarily qualities that are true all things. And so an account of essence must be part of an account of the totality of things. Physical objects do not have essences per se, and essences are not objects of the structuring principle. So that's a lot, but I mean the main point is you can see that the third thing in yellow, essences as a message for all explanations. So here the idea is you start Plato, as we're having developed an account or proto-account of essence, now goes to ask, you know, what is explanation? What is it to give the idea of something? He articulates certain aporia about that, and he then argues that these aporia can be answered if and only if we suppose that essences that explanation is based primarily on essences. So if we now turn to what this means about the reading of the Phaedo, I confess, as it were, that for my sins, I've done the work. The work on this I've done some years ago, and I really haven't got a lot more new to say, except that I put it now part of this wider project. In this paper that you have, explanation of essence in Plato's Phaedo, in the volume edited by David Charles, the Definition of Ancient Philosophy. There I argue that when Plato argues, as we all know, that all explanation causation requires and is based in forms, really what this means is that all explanation causation requires and is based in essences. And I argue this by looking at the text, but also mainly by arguing that his argument, that is to say, starting from certain aporia, certain puzzles about explanation, in order to answer these puzzles, we need not suppose that he means anything else by able here than essence. We need not suppose some stronger notion of a form. And that argument, I'm happy to go through, but we won't have time here. You'll find it in this paper on pages 80 to 84. Just by the by, I mean, some additional evidence, which I didn't mention that in that paper. Of course, as we all know, in 100b, when he introduces the claim that explanation or causation requires forms, he refers to these forms as ekena tapori threneta. And earlier in the dialogue, he uses a very similar phrase, pathri lumina. So it seems that he is expressly telling us, look, this is something familiar. Of course, that doesn't prove that that it's just essences, but it certainly would be consonant with that idea, because essences are sort of familiar from other dialogues. So that's something that we won't have time to go through today, but the point is that as I see the argument, it's a hypothetical argument that starts from causation. What is it to explain or to give a cause of something? It then identifies an aporia and then says, well, argues that aporia can be solved only if and only if we suppose that all explanation is based in forms. But that argument, I argue, it does not require that we suppose that forms are anything over and above essences. And this is what you find on pages 82 to 84. Now, just to ask, you don't need to look at it. So let me just ask, how does this reading differ from more common readings? And what is the significance of this difference? Now, I take it that in more common readings, that argument, that Plato's argument for the claim that causation is based in forms, requires two claims, that the form of F is F, some kind of self-predication, and that the cause of why a thing O is F, that the cause must itself be F. And on the reading I'm defending, based on the idea that all we need is that these forms are essences to understand Plato's argument, we don't need either of these claims. And this is especially important with regard to the second claim, the principle that the cause of a thing's being F must itself be F. I have this feeling that, you know, what forms are, once you lose the basis, in essences, there's very little constraints on what you take forms to be. You can sort of add things and subtract things and get sort of lots of features of a theory of forms. Whereas really, if you stay on course with the being primarily essences, you have very clear constraints. And I, for example, can't see where this principle would come from, that the cause why a thing is F is F. I mean, where it would come from, we could surely find all kinds of historical explanations, but where would it come from in an account, in something which is not logically separate from an account of essence, as it were? I'm against the menu idea. And there I note that it seems again that this principle is a little bit like saying, well, you know, we can't get a theory of forms out of essences alone, so let's suppose we also have a flux thesis. Again, we thereby in doing so, we appeal to something that gives us a theory of forms which is a compound of different, not just different, but quite independent and separate elements. And I think we do better if we try to avoid this and just see it as a development of a theory of essence. Notice here that he isn't in any straightforward way saying, you know, I have a theory of essence, it follows from that explanation must be based on essences. No, it's a much more complex argument. If we forget about the theory of essence, go to explanation, go to an idea, you find yourselves in certain aporia. These aporia have nothing to do with essences or forms on the face of it, but you find that you can only resolve these aporia if and only if you assume that idea are based in essences and forms. So that's the line of argument.
Tend to be complex things that have parts, whereas at least in the Phaedo, and of course things are going to change later on, In the Phaedo, there's an insistence on the simplicity of forms. So I wonder if that doesn't present a wrinkle for your project, in the sense that there does seem to be one strong criteria that would distinguish essences from forms, which is at least in this first presentation of forms, there's a strong insistence on their autos kai kat auto, whereas, of course, there might be more richer metaphysical accounts in which forms could interrelate and be, you know, have all sorts of relations amongst themselves. But in this first blush, Plato seems to insist on the simplicity of forms, whereas do you need to modify your account of essences to make that identity work, or?
Well, no, that's a good question. I think I will have to address it. You know, what do I do with this potential wrinkle? Now, when I talk about essences, I mean, the word essence is not crucial. I'm really talking about the Tiesti question. And if you go to the Tiesti question, I mean, you have in the Hippias Major, I think Hippias thinks you can answer by pointing to a particular, but Socrates has certain requirements. I argue that he has the requirement of generality, unity, and explanatoriness. So the unity requirement is already there in the as one requirement for a proper answer to the Tiesti question in the early dialogues. So that would be what I would try to rely on in addressing that question. Is that okay?
If 10-second rejoinder, but unity of virtue implies that perhaps that these things are one and many at the same time, and that they are conscious. So
somebody pointed, or somebody was talking at a conference in Campinas last week, pointed to a beautiful passage in Republic 500, I think, where the forms are said to be arranged in certain ways. So I wouldn't be immediately confident that we cannot have relationship among forms before, say, the Sophist.
Hi. Two short questions. One, you said that the essences are necessary or that they're required. You said that the essences were necessary or required for all explanation. And they seem to come in later after he isn't able to make nous work. So he seemed like he would be happy if he could have nous work, but somehow because he didn't see how to make that work, he brings them in. So why think that they're necessary or required for all explanations? So that was the first question. And then the second was, were you suggesting that there is something sort of philosophically suspect if the view of forms was a compound of independent theories? Because it's not clear to me why there's anything philosophically suspicious if you sort of, on the one hand, think, look, there's an answer to Tiesti questions. That's one philosophical commitment I have. Here's another philosophical commitment I have. The world is in flux. And so the forms couldn't possibly be found among the sensible things. So those are just two independent philosophical commitments that I have. Do you think that there's something philosophically suspicious about having two independent philosophical commitments that combine to produce a further view? Or is it just, there's nothing suspicious about it, it's just not what your view is? So anyway, there are the two questions.
Thank you. To the first question, when I say that they're necessary, when I say that the forms or essence or what have you is necessary for explanation, the reason why I say that is that when he articulates the problems of traditional account of explanations, which I think have, it's not my view, but it's quite a common view that they have to do with the idea that uniformity, that the explanants and explanandums must be sort of suited to each other, that I think he argues or he can show that this problem can be answered only if we suppose that idea aide or usir. And that's why I use the word necessary. I wasn't saying they're necessary in a sort of absolute sense that it's the best possible theory. It may be that there's another theory which relies on nous, which is better. But my actual view, which I'm not defending here, of course, just to tell you, is that I don't think these two accounts, the nous account and the essence account, are in competition with each other. I think he thinks they could eventually be put together in a single account, as I think we have reason to believe we have something like that in the Tamils. That's the first question. The second question, I agree with you. The mere fact that a philosopher would have two independent elements in a theory is not in itself suspicious. But I do think that, so it has to be shown if there's anything undesirable about that. I've done some work to show this with regard to the flux thesis. And the reasoning that I'm articulating, I didn't present it here, is that if you ask, you know, there's a problem with justifying the theory of forms, then we introduce the flux thesis, and I try to show that the problem recurs. I mean, essentially, the same problem recurs. So the flux thesis may be a good historical explanation, biographical explanation, you know, he was influenced by the Heraclitians, but it won't serve as a good justification, because the problems that you have with the theory of forms, you will also have with the flux thesis, the very same, or practically the same problems. And I think Aristotle is a good example of that. I mean, Aristotle will say, well, I mean, I'm happy to follow the essence bit, but I have a problem with the theory, and that problem is not, you don't answer my problem by introducing the flux thesis, but because I'll have the very same problem with the flux thesis.
Second.
And
how about the great question?
If I understood you, all right. If I understood you, you seem to say you were some sort of Unitarian. You weren't an old-fashioned Unitarian, but a Unitarian. So then this idea of forms as essences would be consistent throughout, I don't know what set of dialogues they would be consistent, but you would have to integrate this idea of forms as essences with, for instance, the symposium, where there's a very strong sense that the form of the beautiful is beautiful. And if I understand you correctly, you think that's not correct. So doubtless has to do with the fact that I haven't read the article, but how do you then handle that language which implies that the form of the beautiful is beautiful, and therefore other forms enjoy what we used to call self-predication, but no longer do.
Yes, thank you. I didn't want to say that I'm against self-predication. What I meant to say, I think what I said, is that this self-predication is not part of the argument for forms, for the claim that explanation requires essences. It's not part of that argument. We don't have to assume any conception of self-predication. In fact, I agree with you as I'm hearing you, that because I think that at its very basic, the theistic question is a request for a standard, and the standard is in a way that I take to be, I would like to have a kind of minimalist reading of self-predication, because standards, I mean, when Hippias says, isn't this a good standard of beauty, he refers to something beautiful. So I wasn't trying to deny that. I'm happy with self-predication, understood in a very minimal way, taken with the idea that essences are standards.
Thank you very much. So the second speaker is Tomas Duozzo, who is teaching at the University of Kansas since 25 years. His dissertation is on fundamental practical reason and the theory of the good in Aristotle's ethics. And his research interests are on Plato, Aristotle, the Presocratics, ancient moral psychology, and ancient theories of causation. One of his representative publications is the Plato's Happiness, Positive Energies in a Socratic Dialogue, and Aristotle and the Discovery of the Efficient Cause, and how dynamic is Aristotle's efficient cause in the epopee. So he speaks on sense perception and explanation in the play.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? In the Phaedo, Socrates disparages the senses as a path to the truth, but does not give any definite explanation of why they are so helpful. He gives us plenty of metaphors. They are deceitful, neither clear nor precise. They confuse the soul. We risk blinding the soul by using them. But how we are to cash out these metaphors is not immediately clear. My project is to determine what the epistemological critique in the Phaedo actually amounts to and what its justification is. Despite the apparent blanket rejection of the senses early on in the so-called apology, the dialogue actually allots some role to the senses in the acquisition of knowledge. What the dialogue is concerned to deny, I think, what it's concerned to deny the senses is any role in the process of constructing theories of explanation. That is to say, it rules out allotting any explanatory role to what is perceived by the senses. The dialogue implicitly offers two different, though related, grounds for the refusal to allow senses any role in explanation. The first of these is what is sometimes called the compresence of opposites. What the senses offer as a possible explanatory entity for a phenomenon turns out to have an equally good claim to be responsible for the opposite phenomenon. Now, while this well-studied Platonic critique of the senses does figure in this dialogue, I'm more interested in the second, I think more important one, the fact that the senses are unable to make sense of wholes. It is through our senses that we become aware of certain features present in the world, such as equality or beauty, but when we try to understand these features by means of the senses, we inevitably fasten onto items as possible explanatia that are in some way merely constituents or parts that we want to understand. The problem with what the senses suggests as explanations is not just that the same things also offer themselves as explanation of contrary phenomena, like the presence of opposites. Rather, the problem is that the phenomena we want to explain are themselves either wholes or are essentially features of wholes, and the unity that characterizes these wholes cannot be accounted for in terms of what perception makes available to us. The only way to explain them is by positing non-sensory principles of unity. That's basically what I'm suggesting, that one source of Socrates' objection to sense perception in the Phaedo is his rejection of reductionist explanation. The defense of the philosophical life in the beginning of the Phaedo contains some of the harshest criticisms of the epistemic value of the senses to be found in that dialogue or anywhere. And of course, this is in addition to the ethical criticisms of the senses. Socrates endorses the claims of the poets that the senses are unclear and deceptive, and that when the philosopher uses them in his effort to understand the forms, they confuse the soul. How they work this deception and confusion, again, he does not hear spell out. While the recollection and affinity arguments give a little more substance to the critique of the senses, I will pass over these here and proceed to reflections on philosophical method and the role of the senses in that method that we find in Socrates' philosophical autobiography and in his discussion of Anaxagoras. Socrates describes his early enthusiasm for and initial forays into natural science in the following passage. Let's read this. I've got the Greek up there for you. And I was always shifting up and down, examining questions like these. Is it, as some said, whenever the hot and the cold give rise to putrefaction that living creatures develop? And it is blood that we think with, or air, or fire? Or is it none of these, but the brain that provides the senses of hearing and seeing and smelling from which memory and judgment come to be? And is it from memory and judgment, when they've acquired stability, that knowledge comes to be? Socrates goes on immediately to say that from his investigation into these questions, he ended up blinded. Okay, here for introduction of the blinding metaphor here. In inquiring into these questions, he ended up blinded to such an extent that he unlearned things he thought he knew. Now, in this discussion of this, this initial discussion of his infatuation with physics, Socrates does not explicitly remark that he had relied on the senses in any methodologically vicious way. He does not specifically link the blinding of his soul here with reliance on the senses. But at the end of the autobiography, he does finally connect these unsatisfactory early attempts at inquiry with the earlier criticism of the senses. And here the metaphor of blinding occurs for the second time in the dialogue. Socrates at this point now compares the epistemic result of these early inquiries to the literal blinding suffered by those who try to study eclipses directly with their eyes. His own blinding, he says, resulted from looking at objects with my eyes and trying to lay hold of them with each of my senses. In future, he'll be more careful. Just as careful investigators of solar eclipses examine the sun through images in media such as water, so he'll inquire into the truth of beings and logos and theories. So in explicitly describing his new method as one by which he hopes to avoid the souls being disturbed by the senses, Socrates gives us a clue as to how to understand the denigration of the senses prominent earlier in the dialogue. That he is in effect giving us the origin story for his current epistemological views expressed earlier is further supported by the fact that his first step in his new method is to posit forms, which in the defense figured precisely as the objects of the philosopher's inquiry, which the senses cannot help him to grasp. After explaining the scientific questions he had investigated and asserting that the investigation had blinded him, Socrates goes on to tell us some of the things that that this blinding caused him to unlearn. So this is another second. These should provide some clue as to what this blinding amounts to. The things he says he unlearned and which he formerly thought obvious and clear are the following. So there are, I have an English and a Greek, and now I'm going to summarize instead of reading. First one is, it was because of eating and drinking that a human being grows. From food, flesh, accrues to flesh and bone to bone, etc. Second, one man is taller than another by a head. The same thing goes for horses. Third one, 10 is greater than 8 because of the accruing of 2 to the latter. And four, a two cubit length is larger than a 1 cubit length because it is exceeded by half of itself. Stephen Menn has pointed out that three of these four examples are versions of examples present in a fragment of the comic poet Epicharmus. I think that's an important influence or intertext with this passage. This fragment presented one of the earliest versions of what became known in later Greek philosophy as the growing argument. And these are the examples here on this handout. Again, I'll just sort of summarize them or abbreviate them. There's three such examples. One is, adding a pebble to a number of pebbles makes the number a different number. Second, adding or subtracting a length from something 1 cubit long makes it no longer a 1 cubit length. And lastly, adding food to a person so that he grows, or generally exchanging the material parts in a person, makes him a different person. I think this clear parallel between the two passages. It will be seen that all of these problems are problems of identity through change, all the Epicharmus problems. He starts with the clearest cases, which are mathematical. A number of objects does not remain that very number when added to or subtracted from, etc. Something 1 foot long doesn't remain 1 foot long when it's added to or taken away from. So two Epicharmus argues, or rather the character in Epicharmus presumably argues, A person who grows after eating is no longer the same person she was before she grew. As he develops this last example, it becomes clear that the actual change in size is incidental to the philosophical heart of the matter. If indeed the various processes of absorption and expulsion of material parts in a person result in a change in the parts that constitute the person, then the character in Epicharmus's play insists we have to say that we have to do with a different person, indeed one who should not be held responsible for the debts contracted by the different constituted person yesterday. I think the passages with the correspondences with the Phaedo passages are striking and significant. I think it shows that in the Phaedo, Plato was concerned with philosophical problems at least closely related to those that inform the paradoxes in Epicharmus. Stephen Men suggested that the question of identity through change is of special importance to the circumstances of the dialogue and its concern with the immortality of the soul. So, for example, will the soul that survives Socrates' death be identical to Socrates or not after that change? I think that is certainly there, that may well be in the background, but I also think that this passage, and in particular the way Plato's text varies from it, is particularly relevant to the question I'm concerned with, namely the dangers that lurk in the use of sense perception in inquiring into the nature of reality. But one of the differences between the Epicharmus passage and Socrates' similar sounding puzzles is that while all of Epicharmus's examples are framed in terms of change, all but the first of Socrates' examples are formulated so as to apply to a non-changing state of affairs. So, whereas Epicharmus points out that when an additional unit is added to a certain number of units, the number of units changes, Socrates wonders whether a pile with 10 units in it is bigger than a pile with 8 units in it in virtue of having 2 additional units. So it's just considering a single state of affairs, not a change. And instead of wondering whether a 1 cubit length remains the same length when part of it is cut off or added, Socrates wonders whether a 2 cubit length is longer than a 1 cubit length in virtue of that half of itself to which the other has nothing corresponding. And in fact, we can see this change that I see in the passage from Epicharmus to the Phaedo is a power level change within the Phaedo itself. When Socrates begins to respond to Cebes' objection, and this change is pretty well known, when he begins to respond to Cebes' objection, Socrates says that responding to it calls for a thorough inquiry into the whole question of the cause of coming to be and perishing. And then later, when he starts that explanation at the beginning of his autobiography, he says that as a younger man, he was interested in knowing the causes of each thing, on account of which each thing comes to be, and on account of which each perishes, and on account of what it is, adding this question of what it is to the questions of change. Indeed, as is often pointed out, the initial safe answer about causes that Socrates comes up with concerns explanations for why things are a certain way. It is only when he introduces his more subtle answers that he begins to explain how things come to be and perish. Come to be the way they are, stop being apparent. And as we'll see, Socrates' concern with explaining certain kinds of being that things have is something that a reliance on the senses obstructs and is one of the reasons for his flight to theories, his positive forms. I want to approach this question by going back a little bit to Socrates' intellectual autobiography, looking not at what he came to unlearn, but at the three questions that were the initial focus of his enthusiasm for natural science. Namely, number one, do living things develop when the hot and cold arise to putrefaction? Two, are we conscious by means of blood, air, or fire? And three, does the brain provide the senses of hearing and sight and smell from which memory comes, and so forth? Okay, thank you. These are all well attested in pre-Socratic speculation, and I just want to point out very quickly. They all ignore what would be, we can assume would be Socrates' answer to these questions at the time of the dialogue, which posits the soul as the source of life, not simply some kind of alteration of the hot and the cold, and then posits recollection as the source of knowledge, not some mass, some accumulation of memories. So I think, just to sum that up, I think what he needs for the what's lacking in his initial enthusiasms, in which he later comes to, is some notion of an intelligible principle of unity that would say account for why hot and cold together with various other things becomes a living thing, and why many instances of memory and perception turn into knowledge. Okay, so all three of his initial interests indicate a willingness to entertain reductionist explanations, which leads then to his blinding. To think that Socrates' initial approach was an infatuation with reductionist explanations, perhaps a slightly different formulation of its of his interest than is often the case. It's often thought he started with concern for mechanistic causes as opposed to teleological ones. Of course, I think mechanistic causes are indeed generally reductionist. But I think to call his earlier concern mechanistic views it too narrowly from the perspective of the Anaxagorean position. Because there might be a third position, both non-reductive and non-teleological. One last puzzle he talks about at the very end of his discussion, so that is not referenced in the, it's not parallel with anything in the Epicharmus passage. Socrates says that very last puzzle, he says, why, I can't even persuade myself any longer that I know why it is that anything comes to be one. And I think that's not just another problem, I think that sums up all the problems. It's how any of these things which have multiple parts and elements, constituents, how can it be one? That's what he needs to, he's unable to find, and then confining himself to the senses. So he says he jumbled together a method of his own, and before going on to talk about it, he talks about Anaxagoras, and in a passage that could be easily, as the commentators notice, could be easily excerpted from the dialogue without any disruption in the argument. He mentions the double method. He could go on to the double method instead. We have Anaxagoras. And just to sort of summarize what I want to say there is when he's interested in Anaxagoras, Anaxagoras posits an intelligent principle of unity, mind. Socrates reads it as a commitment to teleology. And he doesn't say that, indeed, Anaxagoras doesn't seem to use the principle of the good. Socrates is the one who says, if you have a mind, you must have good as the ultimate principle. And so, of course, as famously, he's dissatisfied. But I just want to point to the very end of his discussion of Anaxagoras, where he says, he talks about people the other pre-Socratic who don't follow Anaxagoras, or those who don't take a teleological approach to explanation, says they think they'll one day discover an atlas stronger and immortal than this, which does more to hold everything together. That, in truth, the good and binding, tauton kai deon, is what binds together and holds together. This, they believe, not at all. And so it's the good that binds and that unifies both at the cosmic and at lower levels. So I think that's what he's interested in, trying to find this unifying explanation. So, when his failure to find the appropriate theological explanation leads him to give up, perhaps presumably temporarily, the search for that type of unifying explanation, but he kept his commitment to explaining wholes, which the earlier reliance on senses had made impossible. The positing of forms is a way of invoking non-sensory explanantia that can explain unities that our senses make us aware of.
Thanks a lot for that, Anna. That was very interesting. I was just a bit puzzled about the end when you talked about, well, we shouldn't think that Aristotle, Plato is just not interested in mechanistic causation and it's only upon teleological because you could have a third model that is non-reductionist and non-teleological. And I thought then, well, it's interesting that you mentioned it exactly in the context of Anaxagoras, because in some sense you could say, well, he's the most non-reductionist pre-Socratics, because all this stuff about, you know, finding one principle or rejecting Kant, well, everything is there in the initial mix already, right? So as non-reductionist as you could get, but yet, obviously, this is not what he wants. So this, actually, the Anaxagoras example seems to me especially then a good argument to say, no, he's really interested in teleological one, and the wrong non-reductionism actually that you could get out of Anaxagoras, he's not catching up at all.
Yeah, thank you. That's a very good question. And I guess I have to say, you know, in some sense, Anaxagoras is a non-reductionist. You know, he's not a reductionist insofar as you've got every time you have something else to explain, it's like you have another principle to explain. That sounds not really confusing. But I guess maybe there are different kinds of reductionism, you know, I guess I would say, because I think you'd have, Socrates would think he would have difficulty explaining holes. I mean, so in fact, one of his examples of sort of the problems he came up with in his earlier approach seems to be taken from Anaxagoras. Oh yeah, okay, so how do we get blood? Well, there's blood in everything you eat, so we just separate out the blood. And how do we get flesh? Same story. But how does that fit together to make this whole human being? We were talking about how the parts expand or something like that, but there's still something missing, I think, as an explanation of the whole. So I guess it's that kind of, that kind of, it's still reductionist in that sense. It doesn't explain whole.
Reductionism would just be non-explaining holes, so that's the way you catch that up.
Yes. I mean, I would guess I'd say that's not the only kind of reductionism, okay. But that's yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you for the paper. I like the connection that you made between the earlier rejection of sensation and focusing on forms, and then his autobiography where he's talking about having looked at the physicists, and I think that was very nice. But then he goes on after that and starts talking about fire and snow and hot and cold, and he's obviously talking about the sensible thing. So it's how do you reconcile what comes after with the rejection of the sensation earlier on. He's talking about forms, but he's talking about seemingly sensible forms.
Right. Well, I guess give an interpretation of what he does after that. But I would say there, he does talk about the form of hot and cold. Okay. And obviously the mathematical examples are form. But I do agree. The line that holds that snow is not in the form of snow that's evoked, at least. You have the snow is something that is essentially characterized that all whenever you have snow, there's always in the participation of the form. So I guess I would say he is there. I mean, you might say if you just say, okay, we need to have these principles of unification, which are going to be the forms. And you do need somehow to explain their interaction or, you know, how they are manifest in certain kinds of constellations of sensory phenomena. Right? And I think that the last part of the dialogues is an attempt to, you know, move in that direction. So if you have certain sensible things that are always, whenever they exist, they're always characterized or by a certain essence, you know, a certain quality that they get. Then we can explain things in terms of what that essence, what that quality, we can explain how that quality shows up in things in virtue of how these physical things bring it along. I suppose you might say, well, like fire and hot and homes are at a pretty low level. They're very the sort of things that I'm saying he wants something to explain the organization of, say, in a living thing or a beautiful thing.
It doesn't look like setting aside the objection of sensation and physical things that he's talking about. It jumped out at me as I was listening to speak.
Right. But I guess I'll say, if you posit the form of heat, you're still not, you know, so for example, to think now in terms of atomists or something. You're not committing yourself to any way in which that's necessarily realized and added to the certain or something. You're saying, whatever, that's it.
Okay, the last
question,
best thing.
Thank you for that.
Thank you. I enjoyed your talk, and I thought you made a persuasive case that one of the problems with over-reliance on the senses is not seeing the unity in things. But I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about exactly why it is that reliance on sense perception should necessarily lead to this inability to see the unifying, or to see things as unified. So I can imagine a number of ways that you could go with that, but I wanted to spell that out.
Okay. Yeah. I have a lot to say about that, but I think the thing is that the senses suggest all of these unities to us. I mean, so, and I would think of the equality between two, there's obviously made up of various things go into the equality that one can perceive when one talks about seeing, that some two things are equal and so forth. And then in an attempt to, the idea that in an attempt to explain that, if we say, okay, senses, you were informing us, we have some case of equality here. How do you explain this? What is it that this has that explains equality here that maybe we could use as a general explanation for other cases? I think we're going to be, I would take this word, if by that we are directed towards what Aristotle called primary sensibles or proper sensibles of sense, those are never going to explain that there's something more general or more formal that's going to be required that's not in itself sensible. And so I guess that's what I would think of, maybe early. The principles will always be formal in some sense, and that's not something that the senses could pick up.
Thank you very much.
À l'université de Fribourg en Suisse et il a fait des séjours à Yale University et à l'Université de Californie. Sa thèse a été soutenue en décembre 2012 à Fribourg sur la question de la séparation de la métaphysique de Platon. Et entre 2013 et 2016, il a obtenu un post-doctorat dont il a bénéficié à l'Universidad de Brasilia, à l'Universidad Federal de Pará en Belém et à l'Universidad Federal de Rio de Janeiro. Ses recherches actuelles portent sur la relation entre la métaphysique de Platon et la métaphysique d'Aristote et sur la cosmologie de Platon. Et il est en train de travailler à une traduction portugaise du Lysis de Platon. Il nous parlera aujourd'hui du Phédon et les deux paradigmes de la séparation.
Thank you. I just would like to apologize for talking in French, because that one should always apologize for talking in French, and also I'm not going to read exactly the text that you have. You can follow, but I'm going to try to talk a little freely because have some difficulties to think when I read my own text at least. So I'm going to sum up some of the ideas. There is a handout with some text which will help for the comprehension. Enforcement. L'objectif de ma présentation aujourd'hui est d'essayer d'attirer l'attention sur un point assez simple, à savoir qu'il faut une certaine prudence quand on caractérise la séparation, la distinction entre le sensible et l'intelligible, les formes et les particuliers, et quand on la caractérise en usant une problématique, un vocabulaire, qui est importé de la distinction, de la séparation entre l'âme et le corps. Pour commencer, je vais lire un extrait du livre des définitions d'Aristote, la définition de l'antériorité ontologique. C'est le premier texte sur l'endort. D'une part, dit Aristote, antérieur et postérieur se disent donc ainsi. D'autre part, ils se disent aussi selon la nature et selon la substance, de toutes les choses qui peuvent exister sans d'autres, tandis que celles-là ne peuvent exister sans les premières. Platon a utilisé cette division. Alors, ce qui est intéressant évidemment dans cette définition, c'est que, et je ne discuterai pas aujourd'hui si cela est légitime ou non, mais que la définition classique que l'on trouve dans la littérature de la séparation des formes par rapport aux particuliers est souvent définie comme une capacité à exister indépendamment. Les formes sont séparées du sensible en tant qu'elles jouissent de la capacité, de la potentialité d'exister sans indépendamment des particuliers. C'est une définition très spécifique qui finalement, je citerai après une citation de l'article de Gelfein, à part deux cas spécifiques que sont les formes des objets artificiels et une lecture littérale du Timée, il n'y aurait pas ou il n'y a pas d'exemple clair dans les dialogues de Platon où on pourrait trouver Platon qui affirmerait que les formes peuvent ou jouissent de la capacité d'exister sans les particules. Je lis maintenant un extrait de l'article Separation de Gelfein pour arriver à la question de la relation entre l'âme et le corps. To be sure, c'est le deuxième texte, when the soul is choris from the body, it exists without it. And it is also outtaken. Out then, the converse is not true. Thus, for example, Plato speaks of the philosopher trying to be autos et auton, so far as possible. I do not think it means that the philosopher is trying to exist without his body, even though, to be sure, he regards philosophy as a preparation for death. Je ne sais pas si je devrais parler un peu plus loin du micro, ou si peut-être... Comme ça, ça va? Si je parle comme ça, c'est mieux peut-être. Pardon. Alors, ce qui est intéressant dans ce texte, et le prochain texte va montrer ça encore mieux, c'est qu'il y a une équivalence entre le vocabulaire de la séparation entre l'âme et le corps, et la séparation entre les formes et les particules. Je ne vais pas rentrer dans les détails et juger l'argument ici, je vais simplement citer pour montrer un exemple, et il y en a d'autres dans la littérature secondaire, de ces cas qui vont assumer cette relation forte entre la séparation entre l'âme et le corps, et les formes et les particuliers, en raison d'un vocabulaire commun. Et le texte suivant, qui est un texte de Platon, c'était maintenant un peu Platon, qui est la définition de la mort dans le Phédon, donne du crédit à cette idée, puisque, effectivement, le vocabulaire va apparaître. Je lis, et c'est le texte suivant, je lis la traduction française, je crois que c'est la séparation 1, voilà, c'est celle-là, la mort. Pensons-nous que c'est quelque chose? Oui, assurément, fut la réponse de Simmias. Se peut-il qu'elle soit autre chose que la séparation de l'âme avec le corps? C'est bien cela être mort. Le corps séparé d'avec l'âme en vient à n'être que lui-même en lui-même, tandis que l'âme séparée d'avec le corps est elle-même en elle-même. Se peut-il que la mort soit autre chose que cela? Non, c'est bien cela, dit-il. Alors, ce qui semble intéressant dans cette définition, c'est que nous avons l'équivalence entre le fait d'être séparé, choris, et le fait d'être en soi par soi, autocatauto, qui est affirmé pour l'âme et le corps. La séparation de l'âme et du corps dans cet argument est une séparation en tout cas symétrique. Je pense que ce sera difficile d'argumenter le contraire. Je pense que sur la question de la spatialisation, la question locale, c'est plus compliqué, mais il semble effectivement que l'âme et le corps vont se séparer localement. Pourquoi Platon insiste sur ce point dans ce texte? C'est évidemment dans le cadre du premier argument du phéton. Il a besoin que l'âme puisse voyager pour appliquer ensuite la notion de contraire. Quant à la question du corps, il est évidemment laissé de côté, comme l'a dit d'ailleurs Monique Dixolière dans sa présentation. Nous avons symétrie, la distinction symétrique de deux éléments. On peut rapprocher cela, évidemment, de la distinction de deux objets dans le cadre d'une définition ou dans le cadre, par exemple, même physique, où on sépare deux objets symétriquement l'un de l'autre. Alors, ce qui est intéressant, c'est que ce n'est pas la seule définition de la séparation entre l'âme et le corps dans le phéton. Il y a une deuxième définition, et c'est le texte suivant. Et cette séparation, qu'on peut appeler la vie philosophique, la vie du philosophe, va modifier quelque peu le rapport de séparation. Je lis le texte que j'appelais séparation 1'. Quand donc, reprit Socrate, l'âme atteint-elle la vérité? Quand elle entreprend de faire quelques recherches de concert avec le corps, nous voyons qu'il l'induit en erreur, c'est vrai. N'est-ce pas en raisonnant, si en effet cela arrive, que le réel devient clair à l'âme? Si. Mais l'âme ne raisonne jamais mieux que quand rien ne la trouble, ni l'ouïe, ni la vue, ni la douleur, ni quelque plaisir. Mais qu'au contraire, elle s'isole le plus complètement en elle-même, en renvoyant promener le corps et qu'elle rompt, autant qu'elle peut, tout commerce et tout contact avec lui pour essayer de saisir le réel. C'est juste. Ainsi donc, ici encore, l'âme du philosophe méprise profondément le corps et le fuit et cherche à s'isoler en elle-même. Il me semble. Je lis le prochain texte, qui est aussi sur cette question. Par contre, il nous est tellement prouvé que, si jamais nous devons avoir d'un objet une connaissance épurée, il faudra nous échapper du corps et considérer avec l'âme en elle-même les choses en elle-même. Alors j'ai mis ensuite un petit rapport pour distinguer les deux types de séparation, la première séparation et la deuxième. Dans le cas de cette deuxième séparation, on voit que l'âme est séparée quand elle est pure, quand elle est en elle-même, quand elle considère les réalités qui sont en elle-même. Il s'agit évidemment des formes. Pourquoi cette deuxième séparation me semble intéressante? Puisque, par rapport à la première définition, à la définition traditionnelle de la mort, nous avons ici le rapport d'une séparation qui caractérise seulement un objet et pas l'autre, seule l'âme est elle-même par elle-même. L'âme et le corps ne sont sans doute pas distingués spatialement dans ce cas. En tout cas, imaginez que la relation est la relation de l'union. Il s'agit d'un processus. L'âme est appelée à devenir elle-même par elle-même. C'est un processus idéal. En réalité, elle ne deviendra elle-même par elle-même que au moment de la mort, de la séparation avec le corps. Il s'agit en fait, une parenthèse, mais c'est uniquement à cette occasion que Platon emploie deux fois dans le Phédon l'expression cosmos. Le cosmos pour Platon, c'est ce processus de purification. Et la notion d'indépendance semble faire son apparition. C'est-à-dire que l'âme, lorsqu'elle se met au niveau des formes, lorsqu'elle essaye de penser les formes, sous-entendu de phronésie s'est employé, lorsqu'elle arrive à atteindre la connaissance des formes, elle peut se rendre, tant que cela est possible, et encore une fois c'est un idéal, indépendante du corps. Bon, pourquoi cette définition nous semble intéressante? Puisqu'il y a certains éléments dans cette définition que l'on peut chercher, ou que l'on pourra chercher, à appliquer à la relation entre les formes et les particules. Puisqu'effectivement, les formes, elles, seront séparées, elles seront elles-mêmes par elles-mêmes, et elles jouiront d'une certaine indépendance par rapport aux particules. Je passe maintenant à la question des formes, et c'est le dernier texte. Je lis simplement deux extraits de la séparation 2. La fin du premier paragraphe, du premier texte. Il s'agit évidemment de l'âme qui va contempler cette fois-ci Platon nomme le mot en soi, l'être en soi. Et ensuite il ajoute, ou bien chacune de ces réalités, donc les formes, étant uniforme et en soi par soi, n'est-elle pas invariable, identique à elle-même, sans jamais admettre nulle part, ni en rien, aucun changement? Et Platon affirme également que l'âme, par rapport aux formes, et ça c'est un, évidemment un élément essentiel, possède une parenté avec les formes. L'âme n'est pas une forme, l'âme est l'offre le plus de ressemblance avec les formes. Et, ayant mis ces éléments ensemble, j'aimerais maintenant attirer l'attention sur la différence entre les deux types de séparation. J'ai affirmé un rapport qui est le rapport A, qui est une petite provocation. Peut-on affirmer l'âme est au corps ce que les formes sont au particulier? Il s'agit de deux catégories de réalités séparées qui peuvent exister elles-mêmes par elles-mêmes. Sûrement pas. Cette relation de façon stricte n'est pas possible. Je vais le dire après pourquoi, mais il faut quand même remarquer qu'il y a certaines similitudes entre les deux rapports. Les similitudes sont principalement basées sur le fait que, contrairement à la première définition de la séparation, nous avons ici la notion, je l'ai déjà dit mais je le répète, d'indépendance d'un objet sur l'autre. Seules les formes sont en elles-mêmes par elles-mêmes par rapport aux objets particuliers qui sont toujours dépendants des formes. Seule l'âme, dans cette définition de la vie philosophique, pourra, dans le cadre de ce processus, atteindre un certain degré d'indépendance du corps ou des sens, quand elle essaiera d'avoir accès aux formes. Mais, comme je l'ai dit, ici s'arrête la comparaison, puisque l'âme n'est pas une forme. L'âme est une parenté, possède une parenté avec les formes, mais l'âme n'est pas une forme. Il y a évidemment d'autres différences que l'on pourrait chercher, que l'on pourrait mettre en évidence. La relation entre l'âme et le corps est celle de l'union, la relation entre les formes et les particuliers est celle de la participation. Une âme correspond à un corps pour le rapport à la vie terrestre, alors qu'une forme est exemplifiée par différents particuliers. Il y a d'autres exemples à prendre. Nous avons donc affaire, semble-t-il, à une relation triangulaire dans laquelle l'âme, lorsqu'elle est toujours unie au corps, lors de la vie humaine, si elle tente de connaître les formes, si elle tente de se rapprocher des formes, peut s'extraire, obtenir une certaine indépendance du corps, tout en restant liée avec ce corps. Alors, je passe maintenant c'était assez descriptif jusqu'à maintenant, on a vu les passages, et j'aimerais pour la conclusion tirer quelques éléments qui me semblent importants. Je pense qu'il faut faire preuve d'une certaine prudence lorsque l'on va définir la séparation des formes et des particuliers en tant que capacité à exister indépendant des particuliers. Pourquoi ? Pour deux raisons. D'abord, car dans l'expression capacité à exister indépendamment d'eux, je pense que deux concepts sont délicats. Capacité et exister. L'indépendance, je conclurai sur l'indépendance. Je ne pense pas qu'on puisse éliminer complètement l'indépendance des formes. Mais traduire le fait que les formes, si vous ne voulez pas employer, sont séparées, sont elles-mêmes par elles-mêmes, par la problématique de la capacité à exister, me semble, si ce n'est faux, en tout cas problématique. Et les personnes, et peut-être il y en a dans cette salle, qui veulent défendre la capacité à exister indépendamment des formes, eh bien, je pense que cela doit être un peu plus prouvé que parfois ça l'est fait, parfois c'est juste assumé dans les textes. Pourquoi ? Précisément car je pense que on peut parler, cela fait sens pour une âme, d'exister, de posséder la capacité d'exister indépendamment d'un corps. Et c'est ce que l'on voit dans le Phédon. On a cette situation où l'âme, dans un certain cas, va exister sans le corps et, lors de la vie, possède cette potentialité, cette capacité de s'éloigner du corps, d'exister sans, autant que cela est possible, sans le corps. Cette notion, je dirais, existentielle, s'applique à une réalité comme l'âme. Et ensuite, l'âme va voyager, etc. Bon. Mais je pense qu'appliquer cette notion existentielle à une forme, du moins, sans le justifier, et l'argument que j'essaie de développer aujourd'hui ici est assez modeste, est problématique. C'est-à-dire que j'attendrai plus que simplement d'assumer la notion de capacité d'exister sans appliquer aux formes. Et le deuxième point est sur la notion de capacité. Comme j'ai dit, exister pour une âme, on comprend ce que ça veut dire, posséder une capacité pour une âme d'exister sans corps, on comprend ce que ça veut dire. Posséder une capacité d'exister sans le sensible pour les formes, eh bien, ça ouvre la discussion des formes non instantielles. C'est-à-dire, que seraient les formes sans la participation? Alors, là, ça va être ouvrir une autre discussion, mais je ne pense pas que Platon donne beaucoup d'éléments dans les dialogues en faveur de la discussion de ce que seraient les formes sans les particuliers. Je ne pense pas que ce soit un problème qui intéresse réellement Platon dans sa métaphysique. Je pense que on trouve, Gelfand le dit, les exemples des formes des objets artificiels et d'une lecture littéraire ultimate, qui sont deux cas possibles, et je pense aussi qu'on pourrait parler du Parménide et de la question de la forme de l'esclave et de la forme du maître, qui évidemment sont dans cet argument qui sont complètement séparés et qui possèdent cette capacité, mais en même temps, l'argument est somme toute problématique, puisqu'il y a un maître particulier et un esclave particulier, ainsi, et que les deux doivent être en relation avec les formes correspondantes, même si l'argument va déboucher sur la séparation radicale entre les deux. Je pense en fait qu'on trouve plus chez Platon une réflexion sur la question contraire. La question contraire serait la question de ce que serait le corps, le sensible, sans les formes. Je pense qu'on trouve par exemple dans le Timée, mais là j'extrapole un peu, la question de par exemple l'état du monde, le réceptacle, avant l'intervention ou sans l'intervention, dépendamment de la lecture du démiurge et de la réflexion du modèle dans le réceptacle, la question du milieu chaotique sans les formes. Je pense que Platon pose parfois la question, pardon pour le micro, de l'état chaotique dans lequel serait le monde sans les formes. Mais la question contraire, j'ai plus de peine à la trouver, et je dirais simplement qu'elle est basée sur, je pense, l'importation de la problématique de l'existence indépendante des formes, la capacité à exister indépendamment des formes par rapport aux particuliers, quand cette problématique est importée de la discussion du phénom et de la relation de l'âme et le corps. Et pour conclure, une petite minute. Bah, alors, est-ce que cela signifie que les formes sont elles-mêmes par elles-mêmes, s'il faut être prudent avec ces deux notions? Comme je l'ai dit, je ne pense pas qu'on puisse rejeter la notion d'indépendance. Revenons à l'antériorité ontologique d'Aristote. A est antérieur ontologiquement à B. Aristote nous dit si A peut exister sans B. Peut-être, mais peut-être y a-t-il une autre façon de considérer cette antériorité. Peut-être n'est-on pas obligé d'importer la question de la capacité ou la possibilité de A à exister sans B. Peut-être A est antérieur à B si A, par exemple, est plus fondamental que B. Si A, par exemple, dont je pense que dirait, est plus réel que B. Évidemment, c'est un vocabulaire qu'on trouve dans les dialogues de Platon pour caractériser les formes. Peut-être les adjectifs que prend Platon, de pureté, de stabilité, d'identité, au lieu d'entraîner la problématique dans la notion de cette notion de possibilité, pourraient amener la discussion à la question de l'être des formes en tant que possédant une plénitude ou peut-être une autosuffisance, mais sans toutefois impliquer la discussion de la non-instantiation des formes. Encore une fois, je ne peux pas dire qu'il faut rejeter complètement cette possibilité. Je dis simplement que cette possibilité, à mon avis, est basée sur l'importation d'un vocabulaire qui s'applique mieux dans le cadre d'une discussion peut-être éthique, en tout cas qui concerne l'âme et le corps, et que l'importer dans la discussion métaphysique, si j'ose employer le terme, est somme toute, en tout cas, problématique et demande une certaine prudence. Merci beaucoup et pardon pour le...
dans le cas de l'âme et du corps, parce que il me semblait que tu parlais de type, donc il y a une séparation où les deux entités continuent à exister sont maintenus au rapport, et un autre type où il y a une séparation, comme dans le cas de l'âme du philosophe incarné, qui sépare son âme, mais qui reste dans un corps. Mais en fait, je voulais demander si on peut vraiment distinguer là entre deux types, ou s'il ne s'agit pas du tout d'une question de degré. Parce que dans le cas du philosophe, on pourrait dire qu'il sépare son âme du corps, mais imparfaitement, parce qu'il doit attendre la mort pour vraiment sortir du monde corporel. Tandis que dans le cas du non-philosophe, c'est vrai qu'il y a une séparation de l'âme du corps, dans le sens du corps particulier de l'animal, mais comme il dit dans la partie eschatologique mythique, il reste en rapport avec la corporalité, enfin l'âme prend une dimension corporelle. Et donc je me demande justement si on peut vraiment distinguer de cette façon.
Merci pour la question. Effectivement, peut-être l'expression de catégories ou de sortes de types de séparation est exacte, parce que c'est effectivement dans la continuité du texte, la continuité de l'argument. Simplement, la distinction que je ferai, qui me pousse à distinguer les deux, en simplement les distinguant avec un prime, mais pas disons que ces deux types de séparation différentes, est le contexte. Il me semble que dans le premier cas, nous sommes dans le premier argument du Phédon, dans l'argument des contraires, et qu'on est dans un contexte mythique. Alors, je ne veux pas dire que l'autre n'est pas mythique, mais comme je l'ai dit, l'âme va ensuite voyager. Le corps, on ne sait pas trop ce qui lui arrive, et Platon ne semble pas s'y intéresser. Mais pour le moment, on a l'affirmation d'une distinction radicale. Et les gens se servent de cette séparation, on le voit dans la définition, parce que le vocabulaire de la séparation des formes, et l'expression en soi par soi, apparaît dans cette définition. Le cas de la deuxième séparation, qui est quand même effectivement lié à la question évidemment morale et à la question de la purification, la différence est que dans cet argument, il y a l'introduction des formes et du vocabulaire des formes intelligibles. Et donc, il me semble, et c'est la chose que j'ai voulu dire, est que dans ce cas, on a cette relation triangulaire et qu'il faut être prudent et mettre, je dirais, chaque meuble à sa juste place. Mais bon, je pense que peut-être tu as raison. Il ne s'agit pas de deux choses complètement différentes. Et le philosophe, dans sa vie, quand il est amené à faire cet effort de séparation, la séparation totale, réelle, ne sera effectivement que temporairement.
Bonjour, merci pour votre intervention. Je suis tout à fait d'accord avec vous, en fait. Et vous avez dit qu'il y a une importation du langage du vocabulaire de la séparation du corps, mais peut-être plutôt ce que vous avez dit au début, c'est-à-dire qu'il y a une importation du vocabulaire aristotélicien de la supériorité de la substance. C'est-à-dire l'idée que la substance, celui qui dit existe et non, c'est une idée tout à fait aristotélicienne, c'est pas une idée platonicienne. Et par rapport au fait que ce que ça signifie les cata auta par rapport aux idées chez Platon, je vous dis donc que c'est la formule célèbre auta, cata auta, ae, aux antosecons, c'est-à-dire c'est la continuité dans le temps, c'est pas les droits à exister par soi-même. Et alors, peut-être je peux dire quelque chose que vous avez dit au début. Donc, quel est le jeu? C'est-à-dire, il y a une idée que Platon prend les idées de cette façon, c'est ça votre objectif ou pas? C'est ça ma question. C'est-à-dire que, comme sur ma serre, on fait assez évident que Platon n'a pas ce vocabulaire chez Platon. Quel est vraiment le jeu du point de vue? C'est un jeu de problème du point de vue des études platoniciennes. Comme ce sujet. Il y a des gens qui. L'enjeu. Il y a une théorie, peut-être, je ne sais pas, je ne sais pas. Compris au début de votre intervention, il y a une théorie dans la culture secondaire à ces sujets, à ces propos.
Mais la théorie, c'est la théorie de l'existence, la capacité d'exister.
Oui. Ah, c'est ça, oui.
Non, alors comme j'ai travaillé sur ce sujet pour ma thèse, je trouve qu'on une théorie très très commune d'admettre la séparation des formes comme la capacité à exister indépendamment des particuliers. Et c'est. très commun. Et je ne pense pas d'ailleurs que dans la littérature anglo-saxonne, c'est souvent les gens l'acceptent sans le définir. Et en citant justement le texte d'Aristote, puisque Aristote lui-même dit que Platon a eu ça à l'esprit, Platon a utilisé ce critère, donc ça voudrait dire que, et me semble-t-il, comme je l'ai dit, l'argument était assez modeste, si on veut défendre ça, au moins il faut le prouver.
D'abord, il faut noter que les mots d'Aristote concernent l'antériorité en substance et pas verbalement séparation. C'est une interprétation assez forte de maintenir que là, et Aristote définit la séparation. Ça, c'est un grand effort d'interprétation de ça. Deuxièmement, je ne suis pas certain si vous l'avez déjà dit ce que je dirais. Je n'ai pas tout compris, mais il y a un problème tout au surface de cette définition de séparation comme capacité d'exister indépendamment. Cette capacité introduit une complication. Ça serait plus normal, disons, de dire être séparé, c'est être indépendant, pas avoir la capacité d'être indépendant. Avoir cette capacité doit, de prendre une philosophie, ça doit être la capacité d'être séparé, et être séparé, ça doit être indépendant. Là, il y a un problème philosophique, philosophique dans cette définition très répandue parmi les interprètes.
Merci pour la question. Sur la première remarque, je suis complètement d'accord. En fait, je me suis servi de cette définition de la métaphysique d'Aristote pour arriver à la question de la capacité d'exister indépendamment. Et je l'ai juste dit en passant, peut-être que ce n'est pas effectivement le cas, il faut travailler pour arriver à la notion de... Mais la plupart des gens qui se servent de la capacité à exister indépendamment font, sans justifier, appel à ce passage. Et la deuxième question, si j'ai bien compris, c'est sur la différence entre séparé et séparable, et effectivement, entre le fait d'être séparé et le fait d'avoir la capacité donc d'être séparable. Et on voit aussi on voyait dans le premier texte de Gelfein qu'elle se sert aussi de la relation entre l'âme et le corps, pour distinguer les deux, c'est-à-dire que, par exemple, l'âme ne sera séparée que quand elle aura quitté le corps, alors que l'âme, quand elle est avec le corps, elle a cette capacité. Et elle va user cette distinction qui apparaît dans un contexte psychologique pour l'appliquer à un contexte métaphysique. Et je répéterai encore une fois ce sur quoi j'insistais, c'est que si on veut faire ça, il faut une certaine prudence, ou en tout cas donner quelques arguments pour prouver que c'est bien une théorie qui peut être exportée ainsi.
Dernière question, brève, et on
pense au D'accord. Professor, eu vou precisar do microfone. Obrigado. Posso falar em português?
Bom,
em primeiro lugar, parabéns pela comunicação, que eu achei bastante dinâmica. Assim, acho que foi um pouco diferente das outras, nesse quesito de considerar também a interação do público. Isso, para mim, foi interessante. Minha questão é um pouco, talvez, trivial. Assim, eu gostaria de saber o que você pensa da formulação da questão da separação em termos de teoria dos dois mundos. Você compartilha desses termos relativos à teoria dos dois mundos em Platão? Você usa essa linguagem de um mundo sensível, um mundo inteligível, que afinal de contas são temas que estão relacionados à separação, né?
Pode rapidement la question était sur la relation entre cette question de la séparation et la théorie des deux mondes, two world theory. Tout ce que je vais dire rapidement pour répondre à la question, mais pour en parler après, c'est que effectivement, les gens qui se servent de cette notion de séparation comme capacité d'exister indépendant, c'est le cas de Gelfand dans son article. Ensuite, elle va aller un point plus loin et défendre l'immanence. C'est-à-dire que comme les formes ne sont pas séparées, les formes sont dans le monde. C'est-à-dire qu'en gros, certaines personnes qui défendent cette vision, pas tous, mais débouchent vers l'immanence, ce qui serait contre la théorie des deux mondes. Encore une fois, je pense qu'on peut défendre toutes les possibilités. On peut même trouver des gens qui défendent la capacité d'exister indépendamment et l'idée de la transcendance. Donc voilà, je ne pense pas que forcément les deux soient reliés.